Alright, let me refill my coffee here. Figured this would be a good time to stop and talk to you about what's going on. So the armature and the clay went pretty quick. The armature maybe 10, 15 minutes, slapping the clay on another 10 or 15 minutes. Now things are gonna slow down. First, reference, as you can see over there, get as much reference material as you can. Reference. And then we're gonna talk about tools. I just used my hands so far, but you can only get so far with the hands. So we're gonna talk about some tools. Then we're gonna talk to you about how you can break down the image into measurable units. And then, more importantly, is talk about light and shadow, because that's what's gonna define the form. So if you can match your shadows to the image that you're looking at, you should have a success. Anyway, so let me down this coffee and we'll talk to you about some stuff. Hang in there.
All right, so up to this point, I've just been eyeballing it. But eyeballing it only get you so far, and so now I need to start measuring so that my clay will much closer resemble the image that I'm trying to sculpt. First, I establish my basic shape. So I'm going to measure from the top of my head down to the line of my eyes. And as you can see, it's almost half. Pretty close to being half. And then I can use that same measurement on the profile. So there's my eye, there's about where my chin is at, and then I can take that up there, and it's pretty close to being halfway. And then the mouth is about halfway between there and there.
You can also make smaller measurements, like the eye. See, that's how, excuse me, that's how wide my eye is. And then you can see, that's just about how wide my nose is. Or if I take my eye right there, yeah, my mouth is almost two eyes wide. Most people's faces are five eyes wide. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And so it's just those differences that make us unique. So if you work with averages and then just look for the differences from those averages, you should get there.
On average, people's mouths drop, the corner of their mouth drops right below their eye, the pupil of their eye. Another measurement, the ears. On average, people's ears line up with the pupil of their eye in the corner of their mouth.
You see.
So I can say, okay, that's how wide my head is there. Then I can take that measurement over there and go, okay, I'm pretty close. Or I can take this measurement there and go, okay, I'm pretty close.
Or you can also see that my ear is about a half an eye wide. So if you just take smaller measurements, start big and just keep working those measurements even smaller and smaller and smaller. That's how you do it.
So these are just quick measurements. If I was going to go directly off these measurements that are established in this photo, I could bring some calipers out and then just start going, okay, that's how deep my head is. And so I'm a little bit shy, but this one is just going to be proportionate to itself. So I'm going to be using these measurements of going, okay, this is how wide it is. Because then you can do it at any size, as long as you keep your measurements consistent. Just use, imaginary lines to line stuff up. Halfway, here's the eye, halfway, there's the top of the skull. The mouth is almost about halfway down. Boom. So that's just a quick and easy way to measure. Now let me quickly talk about understanding form through light. My drawing instructor, Diana Addy, I bow to her name, explained it like this. A form will always react to light and have a shadow that will always be the same if that light is the same. So that light helps us understand what that form is doing. So I've got the sphere here, and as I introduce a light source to it, right now it's relatively flat. We see a little bit of shadow in this side, so that tells us that our light source is up here. But if I bring a stronger light into it, and because of the way the shadow is moving around, we understand that that is a round form. And she referred to that as form-shadow sequence. A form will always react to light the same way and cast the same shadow. In looking at our portrait here, when we see the shadows, okay, right there, we understand that that nose is round because the light source is from above. Now, there's multiple light sources here, so we have to take that into account. But right here, we understand that that's round just by the way that shadow is being cast. So that's a form-shadow sequence. So when working on the sculpture here, I want to start replicating those shadows because that's what's going to define the form. So like if I just even just do something like this, we can start to see that form right here that is right there. And that's form shadow sequence. So now I just want to try to match these shadows that are here on there. Think of it this way. It's the shadows on a quarter that makes George George. If it wasn't for the form shadow sequence, George wouldn't be George. And I think George is George. There's George.
So let me go over some tools real quick. Most are standard ceramic tools that you can get at most hobby shop, art supply stores. Just got your standard wood ones. I got a boatload of these. Just, every once in a while I pick one up. Let's see. This one obviously is gonna be too big, but if you're working on bigger stuff, that one's awesome. A lot of them are kind of curved so that you can get in behind stuff. Standard. These are usually pretty inexpensive. 20 years ago it was $1.65. Then the metal ended ones. Oops. These are scrapers. If you want to, if you're trying to make, especially great for folds and hair and stuff. Once again, this one's a little big for what I'm doing. I want to point these out. See how they're kind of discolored from there up? These were in my little cup of ceramic tools in my studio fire. So they got slightly charred. I got a feeling this is going to come in handy. You don't have to spend a lot of money, even just find stuff. Be creative. A toothpick can be a wonderful tool. And don't let a label fool you. Wood carving tools, the inexpensive, real cheap wood carving tools can be great. Because sometimes having a razor edge can work out. I even use an X-Acto knife at times. The brush to get the little clay balls away. A toothbrush can come in handy. These are the tools I probably use the most, especially in the smaller stuff, or just some dental tools or automotive picks or just all-purpose picks. These are great for because the steel is real smooth on clay. This is probably the one I
probably use the most often right here, double-ended. Get yourself some tools. So that about wraps up the tools. Most important tool is water. Don't forget your water. Keep the clay hydrated. There'll come a time when you want it to dry out a little bit, but keep it wet, especially in the beginning, so the clay will move around. Let it harden up a little bit when you want to start doing the detail stuff. I recycle lizard spit guitar polish bottles because the spray head puts out a very, very fine mist, and I like a finer mist as opposed to just, you know, I don't want to spit on it. And that about wraps up the tools.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, I think that zips it up.
Coffee, take a little break, tell you about what I'm gonna do. So I got the basic stuff down with just my hands. And now it's time to start breaking out the tools and thinking about what I'm doing. So we're gonna talk about tools, some simple measuring. Sorry. Some simple measuring and light and shadow. So we'll do that and then we're gonna dive in.